Yes, I am Dr. Janak Patel. I am again starting with another topic we call catheterization, which is very commonly done in both variety, incontinence as well as retention of urine. So we'll be talking on catheterization. We'll be talking on what is the definition, indication, contraindication, different terminology, method, precautions, and complications. When you say catheterization, it means urinary bladder is insertion in the urinary bladder, insertion of a hollow tube through the urethra into bladder for removing urine. It is an aseptic procedure for which a sterile equipment is required. When you say only catheterization, but you don't mention where you are doing it, it is an insertion of a hollow tube into that area for the indicative purpose. Say, as for example, when you do a cardiac catheterization, it is a catheterization by a hollow tube to study coronary artery or you to study right heart or left heart. We call right heart catheterization, left heart catheterization. So you have to mention specifically that catheterization for urinary bladder. It may be for short term, we call intermittent, and you remove it after some period and person is without any catheter. While it is for a long term or indwelling catheter, which is for a longer period, which can be permanent or can be intermittent again. These indwelling catheters are usually utilized in a person who is having a chronic obstruction or a chronic incontinence. There is another procedure by which you put a catheter into bladder from a suprapubic region. Then it is called suprapubic cystostomy. And this is for urinary diversion from a bladder when you cannot approach through per urethra. So you can call urethral catheterization or suprapubic catheterization. Now, indications. The most common indication is retention of urine. It can be acute, can be chronic, or acute on chronic. It is a very commonly done in an ICU setting to calculate input-output chart. In a ICU patient. It is very commonly done in a comatose patient to prevent complication because of retention or because of involuntary passage of urine and overflow dribbling. Also in a person who cannot move about, like paraplegia, dense hemiplegia. In case of neurogenic bladder, all variety, you may need catheterization, like in a upper motor neuron variety or a lower motor neuron variety, or even sometime in a case of a involuntary bladder, or we call as a cortical damage bladder, aneurysis. During operative period, it can be done preoperative, during procedures, we call perioperative, or after operation is over, we call postoperative period. In some of the condition where bladder irrigation is necessary, particularly after doing a prosthetic surgery or after doing any bladder procedures or bladder procedures like biopsy or in a case of a chemotherapy, etc., bladder irrigation can be done. But when you are doing a bladder irrigation, usually the catheter is utilized with a 3 lumen. If there is a wound infection or there is an incontinence, again, catheterization may be needed. In an absolutely bedridden person or a terminal illness person, catheterization is very frequently done to avoid complication because of inability to pass urine. In a bypass, if you want to bypass the obstruction, you may need a catheterization, but invariably this is done is a suprapubic procedure whenever there is an urethral stricture or there is an urethral problems. If you want to give an chemotherapy for a bladder malignancy or prostatic malignancy, this catheterization is also done. While doing a cystography or while doing a cystourethrography or cystometry, these are the diagnostic procedures where catheterization is necessary. And in a case of anuria, if you want to measure input and output chart, catheterization is very, very useful. In other way, urinary retention, post-operative period, terminally ill patient to improve the quality of life, to monitor fluid balance, input and output chart, in a person with a shock or a post-operative person, you want to decompress, or in a person with a severe incontinence, you want to introduce a chemotherapy or irrigation in a TURP, particularly in an enlarged prostate or BPH, it is a very good indication. You can divide into different groups to drain bladder in a case of unconscious person or intubated person, retention like neurogenic bladder, obstruction, clots, etc. We have discussed in detail before. To monitor the output, particularly in a traumatic injury, medical person like congestive heart failure, renal failure, sepsis. If you want to get the urine specimen, which you want a clean catch sample, and you want to send it for culture and antibiotic sensitivity, in a diagnostic procedure like cystometry, urodynamic studies, cystography, maturating cystourethrogram, etc. Even in case of an ascending pyelography, all these procedures you might have to catheterize. It is absolutely contraindicated in certain conditions, particularly if there is an injury to the lower urinary tract. If there is a bleeding at the meatus, scrotal hematoma, high riding prostate, urethral stricture, rupture of urethra, malignancy of urethra, phimosis, paraphimosis, urethritis, lower urinary tract injury, fracture pelvis, prostatitis, and some of the indications which are not related to urethra or bladder, like person has not given a consent or person is having a latex allergy, and if the person is absolutely non-cooperative person, in that case also you should not attempt catheterization per urethra. Indication of a suprapubic cystostomy is very commonly done in a urine retention with where urethral catheterization has failed or it is contraindicated because of urethral trauma, rupture urethra, or there is a fistula, or there is a periurethral abscess, extravasation of urine. If there is a chronic retention in a neurogenic bladder, there is an iatrogenic urethral injury, then an obstruction at the urethral lesion like strictures, bladder neck lesions, severe enlarged prostate, urethral scarring, obstructing phimosis, urethral foreign body, traumatic urethra, and prostatic disruptions. Contraindication for suprapubic, if bladder is completely empty, it will be extremely difficult to do the suprapubic cystostomy. If there is a known bladder cancer, it is contraindicated. If a person has got a bypass, femoral bypass, then also in that case, try to avoid. Extensive scarring, it is a relative contraindication. And if there is a massive hematuria, it is again a relative contraindication. Patient with a coagulopathy, again, relative contraindication depending upon the indications. And if the person has undergone previously a abdominal surgery, these are relative. You have to decide according to the indications. If the person has got history of pelvic cancer, pelvic radiotherapy, ascites, urinary tract infection, and in an uncooperative person, again, they are called relative contraindication, where you will have to judge between the advantage, that is indication, and disadvantage, that is contraindications. Catheterization can be for short term, we call temporary or intermittent, and for a long term, we call as a permanent catheterization. Usually in a long term, it is an indwelling catheter. For a short term, you can use the catheter, which is a simple catheter. It can be in a male and female. Catheter doesn't change. It can be urethral via per urethra or suprapubic. In a suprapubic procedures, it is absolutely different. Depending upon the male and female, depending upon the indications, you can use the catheter with single channel, two channel, or three channel. Three channel is usually for irrigation. Two channel is usually for indwelling catheter. And single channel is usually for intermittent catheter, or we call it a self-intermittent catheters. An external catheter, or we call as condom catheter, is usually utilized only in male and in a person, male person with severe urinary incontinence. It is not indicated. External catheter, or we call as a condom catheter, cannot be of any help in a case of an obstructive etiology. It is only in case of an incontinence, while it is not useful in case of retention of urine. These are the different types of catheter which are available: Foley's catheter, or you can have a Robinson intermittent catheter, which is very frequently either latex or made up of a rubber single tube catheter, TURP catheter, silicone catheter, cord catheter, then condom catheter or external catheter, and suprapubic catheter. Again, I have told you, condom catheter or external catheter is mainly utilized for male person with urinary incontinence. And suprapubic catheter, we have done indication, contraindication, etc. These are the top is suprapubic catheters. This is a condom catheter. This is a urinary catheter, single lumen. This is a silicone catheter, double lumen. This is a Robinson catheter, single lumen catheter. This is a three lumen catheter, which is usually for irrigation, etc. And this is a suprapubic catheter. A straight catheter is usually a single catheter or single lumen catheter. And condom catheter is also called as an external catheter. This is a variety of a single catheter or condom catheter. And these are the different other varieties of catheters. This is irrigation catheter for irrigation. This is a suprapubic catheter. This is per urethra indwelling catheter. This is in a male urethra catheter, and this is in a female suprapubic catheter. This is condom catheter. It can be single way, two way, three way catheter. It can be Foley's catheter, Corday catheter, or it is also called as a Taumann catheter, the tip where it is slightly bent. You can have a Mellicott's catheter, Council catheter, or Cavalier catheters. Size wise, depending upon the lumen size, it is 8, 10, 14, 16, 20, 22. Usually in a children, size of 8 is utilized, and in an adult male, 20, 22 is utilized. And depending upon the holes, you can have indications depending upon the different indications. Before doing a catheterization, you must examine per abdomen, look for distended bladder, look for signs of renal failure, whether there is oliguria or there is a retention, examine the external ureteri meatus, examine the external genital like epididymis for epididymitis, etc. Do a digital rectal examination for prostate enlargement, anal tone, rectal masses, whether there is any consistency. Look at the meatus, urethra, bladder, etc., hernia, and if there is any presence of a neurological damage, particularly to rule out a neurogenic bladder. You can see here are two separate diagrams. In this diagram, you can see there is a huge retention of urine, and after putting in a catheter, see the abdomen. The suprapubic swelling has disappeared, and there is a collection of a huge quantity of a urine. If you drain this suddenly, there is always a chance of hematuria. So always keep it in the mind. If there is a massive retention of urine, don't drain it fast. It can result into hematuria. And large quantity of drainage always is dangerous. Once the drainage is done, urine is sent for microscopic examination, routine examination, and it is sent for culture and antibiotic sensitivity. Simultaneously, you should look for CBC to find out whether there is a presence of infection or not. Blood urea creatinine is done to find out the effect on kidney, because in case of an AKI, urea will be elevated very fast, serum creatinine will be elevated very fast, and it is very common in an acute retention. While in a chronic retention, there is a gradual increase in the urea level and gradual increase in the creatinine level. Ultrasound is very commonly done following a post-voided urine to find out the residual urine capacity. It is very high in case of a chronic retention, and it is also high in a case of a neurogenic bladder. Chest X-ray, ECG, random blood sugar is to rule out other etiology. PSA is very commonly done to find out malignancy of prostate. Role of intravenous urography is doubtful. It can be done only if the serum creatinine is normal and you want to find out the exact site of obstruction. In a urodynamic study, catheterization is very useful to find out uroflowmetry and pressure studies and flow studies. Cystoscopy is useful to identify urethral pathophysiology as well as a bladder pathophysiology. This is what we call as a different types of catheterization we already talked about. This is external catheterization, which is called condom catheterization, while this is urethral catheterization. This is in a male, this is in a female, this is indwelling catheters, so this is for long period of time. This is condom catheter. You can see how the bag is tied. Bag is usually tied on the thigh or on the lower part of the limbs. It is also called as a condom catheter or Texas catheter, or called external catheter. Now, while doing a procedure, first you will have to take the consent of the patient and explain the entire procedure. And you must explain also to the relative. Verbal confirmation of the patient is not enough. Check the file and confirm that consent is taken. Explain the procedure to the patient as well as relative. All equipment should be there on the table. Check the type, size, what you require, different types of catheter, which type of catheter you require, which size, etc. Before putting in a catheter, ask for a latex allergy and allergy to lubricants like xylocaine. You must do a good hand washing with all antiseptic precautions. These are all the material which you require during catheter. These are all the material you require. All should be present on this table. You should have everything on the table. While doing a procedure, some person consider prophylactic antibiotic. Ideally, that should be given only if the person has got a valvular heart disease or person has got suspicion of acute prostatitis. Consider intraurethral anesthetic like xylocaine. Give a proper position. By and large, in a male person, supine position is adequate. In a female, you require a frog leg or a knee flexed, or we call Fowler's positions. Locate the meatus. Apply antiseptics. Gently insert the lubricants tube until the urine is obtained. Inflate the retention balloon slowly with 5 ml to 10 ml of saline depending upon the capacity of the balloon. Connect it to the drainage system. Secure the tube to the tap at a proper place. This is in short the procedure. Now I'll show you all the diagrams showing you the different procedures. So open the sterile drape, place in the position, cover the area with sterile dressing with minimal exposure. Place the sterile drape and apply the xylocaine jelly, and now you start introducing the catheter. This is antiseptic precaution what is being taken. This is the position we call a frog leg, or we call lithotomy position. In a male, usually supine position is adequate. This is lithotomy position. This is supine position in a male. with an antiseptic precaution, clean the area, drape it properly, and usually we say that hold the glands up to the sky, introduce the lubricant and local anesthetic we call xylocaine. Identify the meatus, put the catheter, introduce slowly. It is very easy in a female, but in a case of a male, never push it very fast and never push it hard. Do not inflate until the urine is obtained, and then only inflate the balloon. This is the procedure what is there in a male and in a female. This is in a female. Identify the area and then push the catheter inside. This is in a male. Once the urine is obtained, and then only inflate the balloon. And once inflation is being done, connect it to the drainage tubes. Urine is collected for routine examination and for culture and antibiotic sensitivity. Antibiotic may be started for a short course, and in a case of infective endocarditis prophylaxis, if the person is having a valvular heart disease. As far as possible, always keep it in mind, a person who has got a latex allergy, don't use latex catheters. Keep all antiseptic precautions. Bring back the skin that is prepuce back to the original position. And this is not comfortable. Don't put the tape on the abdomen. It is not a comfortable position. Best comfortable position is on the thigh. So try to fix the back at the thigh, or what we call as a drainage tube at the thigh region. And whenever the drainage tube is full, empty it into a container where you can measure the urine output. And when a person is bedridden, attach that drainage tube and attach it to the bag which is at the side of the bed. This is how it should be emptied out. Sometimes you find difficulty while doing a catheterization, particularly when your selection is not proper. Either the catheter size is not proper, or your procedure is not proper, or indication is not proper. If you try in a person with a urethral pathophysiology like traumatic urethra, or in a case of a stricture, or in a case of a foreign body, malignancy, etc., you'll find difficulty, but never try to do forcibly. And when it is being found, you always try to identify the etiology and try to treat that etiology. And in such cases, always do suprapubic. In a male, if there is a meatal stenosis, try to dilate it by a different procedures. In a case of a urethral strictures, etc., and in a case of a severe and large prostate also, you should not attempt forcibly. As far as possible, always experts should do it. In a suprapubic puncture, it can be open procedure or percutaneous procedure, or sometimes it is temporary or permanent. It is during emergency or elective procedures. You can use balloon catheters or Mallinckrodt's catheter or pigtail catheters. And very frequently it is done under an ultrasound guide. And this is a procedure which is showing you procedure. This is an introduction of trocar. This trocar is removed. And then you introduce a Mallinckrodt's catheter inside this. And then leave the Mallinckrodt's catheter and withdraw the trocar. And then fix it. These are the procedures. These are showing you all the different procedures. Now, complications of catheterization. One of the common complications is incontinence. If repeatedly it is done, you may end up with even a repeated trauma, infection, and strictures. Infection is very, very common if antiseptic precaution is not taken. And following infection, you can develop sepsis. If forcibly catheter is introduced, you can produce urethral injury. And later on, this injury will heal by fibrosis. It will result into urethral strictures. While doing a procedure, you can break the skin. Because of forcible injuries, you can have hematuria. Very rarely, because of repeated catheterization, you can have a rarest possibility, bladder cancer. Urinary tract infection, urethritis, hematuria, abscess formation, pressure ulcer, encrustation, bladder shrinkage, bypassing, traumatic removal, false passage, urethral strictures, and allergy to the latex catheter. These are the most common complications which will come across. Out of which, UTI, that is cystitis, prostatitis, and pyelonephritis are most common. And another common is urethral trauma, traumatic injury to urethra, and later on, the stricture formation. Yes, if antiseptic precaution is not taken, septicemia and septic shock. Short-term complication are traumatic injury, false passage, hematuria, and UTI. While long-term complication is colonization, urethral damage, malignancy, stone formation, hematuria, obstruction, and stricture formation. In a case of a suprapubic, there are a lot of complications like hematuria, perivesical fluid collection, surrounding organ damage if procedure is not done properly, catheter blockage, encrustation, dislodgement, skin site infection, UTI, stone formation, uroepithelial neoplasm, bowel perforation, intra-abdominal viscera injury, uncontrolled hemorrhage, vascular injury, peritonitis, catheter may be misplaced. In case of a person with a bleeding tendency, may have a bleeding in bladder, prostate, or extra urinary area, catheter can get blocked and you can have a adjacent organ damage. Here I end my lecture. I hope this will be useful to you.